Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Human Echoes podcast.
I'm Albert Berg.
And I'm Tony Southcott. We're coming to you with week three of Mockbuster Month, going with a classic 2011 asylum film called Mega Python vs. Gatoroid.
From the director of Pet Sematary.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know that. How did she fall so far?
She honestly, for one thing, let's get this out of the way. Pet Sematary is not a great film. It's a freaky, scary film.
Yeah, it's not fantastic.
Directing-wise.
The kid actor was awesome, though. It's like, let's pick the most adorable kid and have him pretend he's going to zombie people.
But, I mean, she's just been kind of bottom feeding for a while. It's fine, though. I mean, it's not, for one thing, female director. Let's give some shout outs for that, because that's a rarity in Hollywood. Regardless, we're going to say some negative things about this movie, but Hollywood needs more female directors, and props to the Asylum for giving her a shot at this, you know, that was cool. And it's
What's
a female
her name? It's Mary
movie.
What?
I'm sorry? Mary
What's
Lambert?
Mary Lambert. Yeah, I've noticed that. There's like Diablo Cody. There's like a couple others. The woman who did Aeon Flux, Jennifer's Body, and the new movie, The Invitation, something Kurosawa, she does. Is it Kurosawa? I can't remember. She's got an Asian name, even though she does not look Asian at all. I met her at Stanley Film Festival. She's done some really good movies, too.
But it's definitely, you know, it's a man's world in Hollywood, and it's cool to see a woman doing work. This is maybe not the work 100% that you would hope that she would do. I'm going to have to tell my own personal story for this movie first, because I've seen this movie several times, and you guys can go back on our channel and find my Albert vs. the Asylum for Megapython vs. Gatoroid.
That was like 2 years ago. That was one of the first ones you did.
It was way back. I had the Slenderman intro for that too, which looking back on, I'm still kind of proud of. I sort of like spoofed the Marvel Hornets thing and like was walking around in the woods with a suit coat on backwards and then like turn around. I'm just like, what do you guys want? And then went into the review. But it was, I remembered liking it a lot more than I did when I watched it yesterday. But part of the reason for that, for me, was that I was a little bit sick yesterday. Like, I didn't quite vomit, but I was feeling like I might throughout the day. And there was not enough of the camp to bring me out of that sickness. And a lot of the stuff that was pretty bad in this movie just kind of like dragged me further down. And then I saw Tony live tweeting it, and he was just like, this is the worst. I was like, this is so bad.
Well, like the specific moment that that just got a little bit too far for me was probably one of the camp moments that you liked, where you've got like the Tetris sounding music going on, and it's like the montage of the monsters getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
No, I'll tell you what I like about this film. There's a lot of like bit player actors that are in the sides that really, they do a good job. There's the
hunter group.
Well, no, I was thinking of the receptionist, the sort of park ranger receptionist. She's amazing. Like, yeah. She's in a complete, practically in another movie. I mean, not in a, from a plot standpoint, but she's like better than almost anybody else in the movie. And then I thought that the Indian expert on, I think it's herpetology is what they call it, the study of snakes, which that line of itself is just genius, where the secretary lady is talking to Tiffany's character, and she says, you know, we got this Indian fella from the I forget which Indian tribe he's from. And she's like, we don't need some dumb witch doctor. And she says, no, he's a herpetologist. which I really liked. So as an overview, Megapython versus Gatoroid is the story of two women. One of them is an environmentalist. The other one is a conservation park ranger for the Everglades kind of person. The environmentalist woman played by not Tara Reid. What's her name? Blanking here.
Debbie Gibson.
Yes. The other famous pop star from the 80s that's in this movie. Debbie Gibson plays the environmentalist. At the opening of the movie, she's breaking into some guy's house and stealing his snakes, and she sets them free in the Everglades, which, I don't know if you guys are environmentalists and you think that setting invasive species free in a non-standard environment is a good idea, but most environmentalists I know don't think that's a good idea. but So the snakes get out of control in typical giant snake asylum fashion, and one of them ends up killing Tiffany's character's fiance. And so she, in a fit of sort of revenge-fueled rampage, goes and gets these overpowered steroid things, injects them into chickens, and feeds them to the gators in the swamp so the gators can fight the pythons. And we have our mega pythons and our gatoroids duking it out.
Yes, because I'm sure one sample of, like, straight-up steroids is going to do that.
Well, okay, here's something that I will defend about this movie. Granted, yes, that's a little bit silly, but I do like the character arc considered from the one, you know, the 10,000 foot view, where you have these two women who have both created sort of their own version of this apocalypse. They're both responsible for it, and they start off as enemies, and they never really completely reconcile, but they, at the end, realize that it's their thing that they created and come back together to fight it at the end. There is something compelling about that.
All it takes is like a 7-minute fight scene for them, like, just rubbing cake all over each other to, like, really reconcile enough to fight the Gatoroids and Pythons together.
That's maybe the highlight of the whole movie. That and the scene where the Gatoroids are invading the city and, like, they have Mega Petplexes playing their Snakes on a Train, and there's the asylum balloon, and just like all these little in jokes from the asylum.
Yeah, that was probably the most enjoyable part for me, is whenever the snakes and alligators actually start wreaking a little bit of havoc. Like, whenever you're just out there, do you see it swallow an entire train?
Yeah, that's another Easter egg from Snakes on a Train, by the way. That actually, from what I'm told, happens at the ends of Snakes on a Train, where I haven't actually seen Snakes on a Train, so I can't 100% comment, but I think that's where that image is from. But it does, it's sort of this slow process of self-destruction, and you can tell where, with a bigger budget and better actors, this movie could have been some. I mean, granted, most movies would do better with better stuff, you know, the asylum, but it wasn't like at the script level that this was just terrible. There was some bad lines, and obviously the effects and everything, but I mean, for, you know, the sensibilities of this movie, you have a very standard kind of, we start out with a small threat, the threat gets bigger, and then the threat gets really giant towards the end, and you have that big climax. And replacing, if you took most of this movie beat for beat and just, you know, sort of redid it, it wouldn't be a bad story. It's just, it's really amateurishly done.
Yeah, it's not on the level of Birdemic, but it's not that much further past it as far as the composition. The script is 1,000 times better than Birdemic. The CGI and the other things, it's a step up, but it's still not there. At least they got a real editor for it.
Like, yeah, the editing, the alligators aren't just hopping up and down in place for the whole movie.
Yeah. I feel like the bar for low movies has actually been reset by Birdemic. We've seen a lot of movies, and like, for a little bit, it would be various asylum films that I put at the bottom of that list, but that definitely lowered it a little bit more. Maybe that's what the main purpose of Mockbuster Month is, just to show me how far things can go.
I think I had more fun with Birdemic, though, this time around now. Now, again, I can't tell if this is because I was sick, and it very well could have been, but Birdemic, there were a lot of moments, excuse me, that I was able to laugh at and really just, you know, kind of revel in the awkward weirdness of the whole thing. This one is a little bit closer to, you know, trying to be something. It's still the, you know, the low budget. They're still shooting it in like 2 weeks, which is just not enough time, really, to get all of your movie together. And they're using pop star actors who are not, I mean, really, they're just pop stars. Although, I will say, Tiffany, despite the fact that she's not a great actor, she has enough interesting screen presence where you don't hate her. You kind of hate Debbie Gibson in this. You're like, oh, yeah. What is your problem, woman? You're so screechy and annoying.
Definitely had that thought a little bit. Like, even whenever she's in peril and everything, you're kind of hoping she gets eaten. Whereas with Dr. Ortiz and Tiffany's character, like, you're definitely on their side.
So, there's not a ton to say about this other than that. I feel really bad that I'm not here to defend this, because I'm usually the one I think that would be coming to the defense of these movies. And there are some amazing lines. So for me, we have to get a bigger gator. Like, when I did that review, every time I saw that movie before, I was like, that's amazing. And again, I think it was being sick, but this time that just rolled over me. But to say, for her to get into that middle of her grief, you know, and her fiance, and her solution is to build a giant steroid fueled gator and to yell that we have to make a bigger gator.
And then, like, the secretary who has the only subtle performance in this movie is like, okay, I'll get you a bigger gator.
Well, she starts out with like, okay, yeah, go home. You're like clearly not in a good headspace for it. But then Tiffany is so distraught, she actually convinces her to go
to
maybe
her,
the
like,
biggest leap in logic
grandson.
Character-wise in the movie is that she goes to get that steroid stuff from her friend at the hospital.
I thought that was like that one woman's grandson or something. It was definitely an awkward scene. He's just like all muscle bound and he's like, my people won't even take this stuff because it's that powerful. But oh well.
I got the idea that he worked at the hospital and maybe skimmed off some of the steroids for himself, but also that he was saying that it was like a research thing developed at the hospital where they were like, this is not ready. I didn't get the idea that he was supposed to be exactly some musclehead. He seemed like he not at a hospital?
He was in like a kitchen.
Was it a kitchen?
Yeah, it would look like a kitchen in somebody's house.
Okay.
They didn't have like a proper kitchen, like a proper place for him to be in, so they put him in a kitchen.
I could have swore that scene takes place at a hospital.
Maybe
I'm just stupid.
Maybe I'm just forgetting it. Like, there were a lot of things that I kind of blocked out. Like, at one point, I was literally just listening to the movie, staring at my wall, like just taking a break.
I have to admit I did that too, but it was partly just me trying not to throw up.
Asylum movies have that effect. You could pretty much bottle it as epicac.
However, I have to point out for our listeners, last week we talked about this one too also had a musical number in it. They put two pop stars in it. They felt the need to include their most famous songs, I guess. Or maybe not most famous. I have no idea. But they were able to get the rights to a song by each of these women. And they play it over that montage of the alligator or the Gatoroids and the pythons growing and the gators getting bigger. It's not a great song.
No.
It's not a great sequence. And
it was like a weird, like Tetris sounding song too. It felt so weird. And they added a third pop star to it as well. They got one of the guys from the band The Monkees to be in this.
How is a monkey going to save the Everglades? that joke was a lot funnier before he showed up, honestly, to me.
Yeah.
But
I mean, like, I think people might be more impressed by just having like a chimp around, get their wallets out faster.
My favorite thing about his appearance is that they did not license any of his songs, so he gets eaten immediately.
Here's one
I'm going to start out
hits.
With one of my famous songs from the 60s. I'm getting chomped. That was a thing. That guy showed up for a day. You could tell he was just like, he's there for the day. He's getting a paycheck. They're like, yeah, we'll throw his face on. I don't even know if they put his face on it. I don't know if they used his star power at all. It seems almost like a waste to have him in
like
the movie.
Who from the Monkees actually still has like relevant star power? I couldn't name you a single Monkees song.
I didn't
even play their own instruments.
I don't have any thoughts or opinions one way or the other about the Monkees. I know that they were a band and that's it. I know that there was a really cute girl in my high school that loved the Monkees. And so from that aspect alone, I'm just going to be like, you know what? They're pretty awesome. In case she's watching. 12 years later. But, you know, it tries. I think, again, it's one of those movies, I think, given what it's working with, you can't hate too much. If you take into account the fact that they shoot these things in 2 weeks, that they don't have actual people who can act.
That they have like 5 days, 10 days max to do the special effects.
Yeah, if you put all that in together, then I think this is the best movie they could have made compared to last week's Birdemic, where the point I get to in my Human Echoes rundown that I wrote for that, which is going to it's up on Tuesday, you guys, if you want to check that out, previous Tuesday, is that I really feel like James, how do you pronounce that last name? Nguyen? What's the director Nguyen. Of Birdemic? Yeah. What?
Nguyen.
Nguyen. Okay. I'm very sorry. I'm not trying to be insensitive at all.
It's a Vietnamese name a few of my friends had it growing up, so that's the only reason why I know how to pronounce it.
I've seen it a lot. I know it's a famous name, but in my mind, I'm just like, I want to pronounce all the syllables really hard. But I really legitimately think he didn't, like, try. He didn't try to make a good movie because he doesn't, to go back to something like that where you have, he doesn't even get the environmental message right. He makes this whole movie about global warming and he doesn't know anything about global warming.
Sorry, that bugs me. My arena story this week was laden with like bad science and things like that. So
yes, but he worked on this movie for 4 years. I mean, a lot of that was, you know, trying to get the special effects done, and I don't know how that took 4 years, but anyway, you know, marketing and things like that. But if it could have been better from his perspective. If you're going to make your indie film, then put the passion into it, put the workmanship into it that you can put into it. Don't make the minimum effort.
Yeah, but then you can't make it like legendarily bad.
Yeah. Maybe. I mean, do you think people will still be talking about Birdemic 20 years from now?
I think it's more likely they'd be talking about Birdemic than Megapython versus Gatoroid.
Yeah, well, that's true. But, okay, let's put it up against two legendary bad, quote-unquote bad films. Birdemic versus Sharknado.
It'll be interesting to see. Like, I could see it being kind of a footnote of bad movies, but I don't think people are going to be able to even go back and just tolerate it 20 years from now. As we, like, put on our VR headsets and live the movies or whatever we're going to end up doing.
Like, is there a game? It seems like there ought to be a game. By the way, speaking of minimum effort on Birdemic, I'm just going to keep harping on this guy. I went and looked at the website for Birdemic. That, like, there were better web pages in the 90s. That is nothing but white, black text on a white background with a picture and a link. What?
We've been looking at a lot of different ways to promote the arena lately, and we were going to all these different writers associations that have been around forever, and you would be surprised at how many of these look like a GeoCities or like Angel Fire website. Like, it's so weird that people are actually giving money to these people whenever I wouldn't trust that site for anything.
I think if you've been around for a while, it's less about the website and more about the, you know, legacy.
Yeah, but you're talking about like the Science Fiction Writers Association or some of these other ones. It's like, if you're writing sci-fi books, you should at least have a website that looks like it was produced this decade.
If you're gonna be in the future, you should at least try to keep up with the present. Is that what you're saying? Yeah,
pretty much.
Now that is a really great point.
It's like, slap a WordPress template on it and be done.
That's bad. I was thinking of like drama, like literature, you know, like some prestigious sort of, but if it's sci-fi, yeah, horror, even horror could get away from it. Cause it can be just sort of like drabby, like here's some skulls or something, but
you here's can't, a crow.
Most places are pretty okay though. I mean, I've been on the Clark's World website. They look pretty legit.
Yeah, well, Clark's World also puts so much like composition to their covers and things like that. I love that magazine just in general.
I used to listen to their podcast a lot. They used to have release stories from the magazine on their podcast. And I used to listen to it, but then I got annoyed with the low production value and I left.
Yeah. Especially because
low production value is obviously very important to me, Tony. You can tell from the movies that I pick.
Well, with audio production, I can definitely tell that you're a little bit more of a stickler on it, especially whenever you listen to stuff like No Sleep and various others. Like, sometimes Pseudopod like has a bad reader or something, but for the most part, a lot of their stories are actually done well. I feel like the Drabblecast just has been going to like once every 3 months instead of once or twice a month. Kind of miss it.
I haven't even, I'm not even subscribed to the Drabblecast anymore, but I mean, I guess that that's the time that they need to do their thing. I mean, you can't have H.P. Lovecraft month if you don't have four stories in a month, right?
Yeah. But it might just be that it seems like it's further apart. I just remember it was like clockwork for a while. Now my new jab is something you introduced me to with King Falls AM.
Oh, man, I'm so... That's a... Especially for those of you who are caught up on King Falls AM, and I guess we're done talking about MegaPython versus Gatoroid, which is great. I will say, by the way, and in apology, I have agreed to watch a movie of Tony's choice in the dark. Tony's gonna pick a scary movie for me, and I'm gonna watch it with the lights off.
I'm open to suggestions if any of you guys have something. I was thinking of The Ring just because I feel like that's a movie that would make him kind of squirm, kind of just get really freaked out. It was the last movie that honestly like terrified me whenever I was in theaters. So I'm thinking about going with that, but I am very open to suggestions, especially from my Jen, which is Mortem Posts, like anyone like that. If you guys want to throw me some scary movies, I will pick this and it'll be for early next month.
Tweet at T Southcott within the next couple weeks with your suggestions. Hashtag owl movies suck. or Mockbuster month or something. I don't know. I'm not the same sick as I was last week, but I'm a little bit sick. So I want to apologize for being slightly low energy this week. But I did want to talk about King Falls AM. For those of you who don't know about King Falls AM, if you've been listening to the podcast for a while, you know that I went on just a rampage rant at Welcome to Night Vale. That podcast is, I'm not going to go back into the rant because I don't hate Welcome to Night Vale, but it was never what I wanted it to be. Like they're presenting this as a radio program about this weird place. And yet it's just a dude reading weird things off of a page. And I wanted it more. I wanted it to sound like a legit radio program because I used to listen to the radio all the time. And I was like, where is my radio program about a weird place? And somebody comes up with King Falls AM, which is, I mean, they have call-in segments. They play commercials that are like from the people in the town. They have a
huge cast of characters that call in on a very, very regular basis too. And it's that, I'd say there's at least like 10 to 12 regulars that all have very unique personalities for the town.
I think it's the same woman playing all the female parts. I actually feel like that there's several, they have some pretty good voice actors that are stretching their voices to do some of the same voices.
Yeah, but I could see like Emily being like that other old shrewd lady and everything.
Well, and the wife of what's-his-face. But, I mean, Emily, like, did you hear the last episode?
Yeah, I'm caught up.
I was like, I know you don't necessarily love the romance aspect between Emily and
like, I like that they're... I don't like how sheepish he is and how slow he is at getting to the romance part of it. So, like, I honestly understand that, like, it's a long recurring segment. He's kind of a wuss. But, like, I still like their relationship as far as how much he cares about her.
Anyway, it's a show with real characters. Not only do they put production value into it, not only are they not just saying crazy things in a sequence like Night Vale is, but they actually have these, like, cool characters and storylines, and I don't want to spoil it, but there was the incident where What's-His-Face came back, and then this last episode ended on that giant cliffhanger, and you're like, oh my gosh! And I think
I'm one episode ahead of you, actually.
What?
Yeah.
Is there a new one out?
2 days ago.
It didn't notify me. Dang you, Google Play Music! You failed me again! I'm downloading it right now! Hold on. Everybody take a chill pill. I'm downloading the new King Falls.
It's definitely a digestible show, too. You're talking about like 20, 25 minutes once every 2 weeks. I started from the very beginning. They started at a very high level of production value, so it's a show that's been a lot of fun to watch grow. They're in the same like podcast award nomination as we are, so I gave them a couple nominations. Not in our category, but, you know.
Yeah, well, we're better, Tony.
Yeah.
Obviously. I also wanted to share a quick little bit of movie news with you guys. I saw this on Twitter today from Film Clickbait, which if you guys aren't following Film Clickbait, you should be. Because they just retweet all the popular news sites with their clickbait titles and then just tell you what the answer is. And it's amazing. But it says, the new Transformers 5 movie has gotten its title, Tony. Did you see this? Did you see what the title is?
I saw what it was, but I'm not going to ruin your announcement.
Transformers The Last Night.
Night is spelled
with
like
a K.
Yeah.
The night has a K. Transformers doesn't have a K. You can't fit you can't fit a K in Transformers.
I'm sure you probably could if you were German.
that is like, I don't, it's such a bad good name, Tony. It's so cheesy and weird and ambiguous and
probably not the last one.
No, definitely not. No, but I assume Optimus Prime is going to be like the knight or whatever, because he has the, you know, the sword and everything now, and he had the rocket boots to blast off into space. But I really don't know what it was about this title, but something about it's not good. It's not a great title. But it just hit all those buttons with like the weird, you know, use of knight instead of knight, and it, you know, the punny thing, and calling it it's so many different like title tropes kind of cannonballed into one. I mean, the only thing that it doesn't have is Rises. Okay, if they had The Last Night Rises, that would be that would be so perfect.
That no, or that's Dawn? Number six.
What?
That'll be number six.
Yeah, I guess it could be, or the new night. The Night Once More. Somebody wrote that. That's that's G. Wells Taylor, right?
Man, I just it's like a sour thing seeing that turn into like a 5-part movie series after how bad the second was. I haven't been able to bring myself to get back into it at all since the second movie. It was one of the most disappointing cinema going experiences of my entire life, because I loved that first one so much.
If let's play a game here. Let's say that you are an executive at, I think it's Warner Brothers that produces the Transformers. But I could be wrong. Oh, it's Paramount. It's Paramount. My bad. You're executive at Paramount. They release these movies, the Transformers movies, 1 through 4, right? And they're all making buku bucks. All right. Well, Transformers 4 made $1 billion, which is a lot of money for a movie.
Yeah. I brought that up to someone the other day. They were like, how, I bet they're not even making money. I'm like, you do not understand international sales or what this franchise is capable of. It made $1 billion, not counting the merchandise.
So here's my question to you. Do you try to make it better? If you're the executive over there, do you try to be like, okay, well, yeah, it's making a lot of money, but we could fix it and it would still make a lot of money, right? Or do you just be like, we're just going to hang on to all the pieces that we have here. I don't know what it is, but they keep giving us all the money, so we're just going to keep doing this.
Well, they kind of, like, would you agree that they kind of did that with Fast and Furious, where like the middle one sagged a little bit and they ended up repairing them as they went?
But I think those started to lose money. I don't know exactly what the history of Fast and Furious was, but I think that people weren't really excited for Fast and Furious movies by the time, you know, Tokyo Drift came out. But Justin Lin got on and he said, hey, I've got some ideas. And he took a series that probably would have died without him and revitalized it by making good movies. These are not movies that are going to die.
Yeah, unfortunately.
I don't know what kind of movie you have to make people not see a Transformers movie. And then you get, you know, Pacific Rim by Guillermo del Toro, which is, I don't think it's a great movie, but I think it's pretty good. And it barely makes back its budget. I mean, it did squeak over the line where it's like, okay, it was technically profitable, but it wasn't like an instant, all right, pulling the trigger on Pacific Rim 2. They had to really fight for that, and I think we're still waiting on them to get that out.
Yeah, it sounded like that got postponed for a little bit, so it might not even happen now.
So, Transformers, do you try to make it better? Do you worry that if you make Transformers better, you break the formula and people stop watching it?
I think it would be worth doing either way. Like, honestly, okay. Like, just for the sake of having movies that are good, I can't stand the idea that they're just kind of sandbagging it for money.
I would like to see them do better ones. I've enjoyed all of the ones except for two. I really hated two. But I found some enjoyment in all the other ones. I don't think they're great movies, but I will defend my enjoyment of them if you want to attack that. And, you know, I would like to see them do better. I would like to see a different director. I think Michael Bay, I legitimately think he doesn't care about these movies because we've seen him make good movies. And, you know, I haven't seen Benghazi, the 13 Hours movie yet, but I didn't hear anybody saying, coming out of that saying, this is just garbage. And I mean, some people didn't like it as much, but he doesn't phone everything in like it seems like he just phones in Transformers.
Yeah, like we saw what he did with Pain and Gain. You go back and you watch The Rock, and that's still a fun action movie, even if it's just absolutely dripping with like Michael Bay-ness on it. Like, it was still fun.
I mean, Armageddon, for all of its faults, as a progressing narrative, makes some kind of sense. Transformers has just those long slogs of like, why are we, what are we doing here? What is going on? I don't understand 100% what is happening in the plot. We just run around for a lot and then get to the end. Especially four was really guilty of that. And two was just practically unwatchable. But it's an interesting conundrum. By the way, speaking of conundrums and giant monsters, did you also hear that Gareth Edwards left Godzilla 2?
I saw that you tweeted about it. I didn't know if it was specifically talking about Godzilla or something else. I only saw that, like, and they waited to do the franchise, like, so I got half the tweets.
I'm so ticked off about that. So Godzilla comes out, right? And whatever your thoughts about that movie are, I loved it. All right, I know some of y'all didn't. I hear people fight about it on the movie shows that I listen to all the time. Not trying to convince you, but it did well, okay? And Universal, I think, is behind that. They liked it enough where they're like, hey, we're going to make another one of these. They liked it so much that they said to Gareth Edwards, we want you to make another one of these. And Gareth Edwards said to Universal, hey, I got this little thing that they offer me called Star Wars Rogue One. It's kind of a big deal. I think I'm going to go do that. And they said, we'll wait for you, man. We will wait until you're ready, and then we'll make Godzilla 2. You finish up your Star Wars movie, it'll be all good. So we had to wait until 2018 for another Godzilla movie. Okay, I'm not really happy about that, Tony. I could be like, you know what, fine. But we could have put somebody else in there and got Godzilla 2 in, and then he could have come back for Godzilla 3 in like 2019. Would have been fine, but no. Universal decides they want to ride this horse that's did them pretty good for the first one. So they're riding the horse until last week when Gareth Edwards come out and he says, yeah, I'm not on Godzilla 2 anymore. And what is the news after that? They're postponing it again. They're postponing it further because Gareth Edwards not on anymore. You postponed it because he was on it. Now you're postponing it because he's not on it. What are you doing with my Godzilla movie?
You're probably making it so that the next director has enough time to make a good movie instead of just taking like half-baked ideas and unfinished scripts.
He could have been working on it all this time. Ever since 2014, he could have been working on it. We could have had a trailer today. Today we could have a trailer, Tony.
Well, if they've been working, like, there's a new Godzilla that's Japanese coming out, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a Toho Godzilla. That's fine.
You could sate your Godzilla needs with that.
Those are really hit or miss. Granted, I guess the American Godzillas are really hit or miss, just sort of like Batman. You know, you get that was one of the like great revelations to me when I was like, why are these Toho movies all over the place? You know, it's always Godzilla. It's always the same company. How are they sometimes great and sometimes not? And I was talking to my friend Brantley about it, and he said, well, it's like Batman. You know, it's always Warner Brothers producing it. It's always the same character. You don't always make a great Batman movie. Some of them are kind of crap. And I don't know how I couldn't think of it that way, but somehow, like, with them being over there in Japan and like all I know of them is doing is Godzilla stuff, I didn't think about it in those terms. But
yeah, it's like how Batman vs. Superman is going to be far inferior to the Lego Batman.
Yeah, plus I'm waiting for my Gamera movie. Where's that at? Where's Gamera at? I got the new Gamera. I saw the trailer for that. It looked awesome. He fought off all those flying things. Where's my DVD? I assume it's not going to show up on, you know, American movie screen theaters. So, yes, that's a thing. American movie screen theaters, Tony. How does English? Why did the birds attacked?
I didn't, like, I knew you were passionate about this. I didn't know it quite went to that level where you're summoning so much anger through sickness, through everything else for your Godzilla.
It's just frustration. It is such a level of frustration that they made it, like, Gareth Edwards was like, yeah, we're gonna wait, and then we have to wait some more. It's the, it's like this weird rabbit chasing its tail thing. We could have had so many giant monster movies, and we don't.
Well, at least we have Rogue One.
Maybe we need you know what we need? We need Marvel to get the rights to who's the guy? The guy who gets big, not Mega Man. Not Ultraman. You know what I'm talking about? He fights Godzilla. Jaguar. We need to get Marvel to make you need to bring him into the Marvel universe and make a Jet Jaguar movie, and then Jet Jaguar turns into a giant monster, sort of, and could kick around things. If he was a superhero, it would get made, like, next week, Tony. We would have a superhero movie if he was a giant monster movie, it was superheroes, but no.
Well, you could always have Godzilla try to fight Galactus or something.
I think I'm getting that superhero fatigue everybody's been talking about. Now I'm just yelling about, like, we got all these superhero movies and those giant Godzilla monster movies, the Gamera.
Well, the summer movie thing is coming to an end, so you've got until December before. Actually, no, you've got Suicide Squad still. That's coming up pretty quick.
We still have X-Men? What are you saying, the summer movies are coming to the... Oh, like, we also still have Doctor Strange?
Yeah, but, well, like, X-Men doesn't really count because nobody's going to care about that one. Like, Doctor Strange could be interesting, though.
Well, I remember Days of Future Past. Well, I did not love that movie. That movie got a lot of buzz. I mean, people were very excited for that one. This new X-Men movie is not like that. Are not really happy about this new X-Men movie.
I saw
movie.
The rating being sub 50% on Rotten Tomatoes among critics, but we'll see how it does.
From what I've seen on Rotten Tomatoes now, it's not getting trashed, but it is getting... It's not being praised either. It's
the word I'm seeing over and over again is unexceptional.
Which, for a movie called Apocalypse, with a dude called Apocalypse, that's disappointing.
Especially because it's supposed to be one of the final, like, quintessential X-Men, like, arcs to have that happen.
Well, it's kind of like Ultron, right? A lot of people were really psyched for Ultron, but he didn't deliver the way people wanted him to deliver. It wasn't...
Oh, like, you everybody know, expects it to be kind of more like the cartoons and everything, where Ultron ends up, like, it's in the far future, and you've got, like, old Tony Stark with a bunch of young Marvel characters, and everybody else is dead, and they're having to, like, reset timelines and all sorts of other things. So
I don't think they were expecting that. I just think that that movie was disappointing in the sense that it was not quite what everybody hoped it was. Now, disappointing doesn't mean bad, but it was not at the level that I think... I wanted, okay? It was not... The trailers had me very, very hyped, and the movie, for me, did not live up to the hype. Yeah, it was, like, good.
I got chills from the trailer, and I just kept waiting in the theater for it to become, like, great instead of just good.
So it's tough to pull those off, but they nailed it with Civil War, and, it, you know, it's just hard in general to make any movie, and these are giant spectacle movies, so I'm not gonna hate on anybody in particular, but it does, it's interesting, you know, the arc that we see. I hope that Bryan Singer gets to go away and do other things, and maybe let other people do X-Men movies for a bit.
Yeah, that would be a good thing. It's also interesting that Civil War was able to be better than all those without having a world-ending existential threat.
You know, the one thing that I do wonder about and worry about a lot is... We a lot of times when we see the same director stay on a franchise for more than a couple movies, it tends to go downhill. Joss Whedon, second Avengers, not as good as the first Whedon Avengers. You know, Sam Raimi, get to Spider-Man 3, and, you know, he's kind of run out of steam. And now we had with the X-Men movies, we got the second or the third new X-Men movie directed by
Singer.
What's his face? Singer, yes. And... It seems like that's kind of falling off. I worry about the Russo brothers and Infinity War, Tony. I worry that they're going to get that same level of burnout with Marvel. I hope that it doesn't happen. But, I mean, that they've been building up to that for a long time. And they're leaning on these guys for the third time. It's two people now, so maybe between the two of them, they'll have the energy and the creative juices to crank out another really great film. But there's a part of me that thinks maybe you need to let these people go off and do other types of stories for a bit before you ask them to keep going with the Marvel Universe. Because there's that sense of, let's keep riding the same horse, right? It's worked for us, it's worked for us, it's worked for us. Well, that horse is tired of running the same race eventually. He wants to go off and wander through some meadows for a bit.
Yeah, it's like, I kind of wonder, is J.J. Abrams the director for the third Star Trek?
No, it's Justin Lin.
All right, so they switched that up at least.
Yes, which I think was a good call. A lot of people are sort of iffy about Justin Lin in that Star Trek movie, but especially with the trailer. But I think I have a lot of faith in Lin. I think he's a thoughtful action director where he does big action, but he understands how big action works and how, you know, the importance of characters in big action. And even though there will be people who will scoff at, you know, how character driven the Fast and Furious movies are, if you don't have moments of character, even if they're cheesy or a little bit over the top, if you don't have those to ground you in those universes, I think the action falls flat. And Justin Lin really understands that. And so I'm hoping that he'll have that same kind of effect on the Star Trek movies.
Yeah. And what you're talking about with like all three movies are like trilogies done by the same director. Think about the Nolan Batman, where like the final move, like the first movie was good, the second movie was great, and the third movie was just good. It wasn't anything near what the second movie was, though.
It didn't live up to the expectations he set.
Yeah.
I will still, the people on the internet, everything is either great or awful. And I think that people, want to put things in that. The Batman, Dark Knight Rises is not awful.
Yeah.
Okay. It's got some problems, but it's fine. You know, it's fine. It's okay. It's not what you wanted, and it's not really what I wanted, but I didn't leave the theater thinking, that was complete garbage.
Well, I was in a conversation the other day with a bunch of people about Marvel Cinematic Universe, and there were people that were saying that they would rather get AIDS than watch Iron Man 3 again.
What?
That's just how far people take some of this stuff.
Yeah. I assume that person was not actually being honest, Tony.
I know. I'm just saying that's how the vitriol gets just so like out there with how people feel on these movies. Because Iron Man 3 was probably my least favorite of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but I'm still gonna end up watching it on this like slow quest to get back through all those movies. It's not like I'm just gonna skip it.
I'm trying to think of what my least favorite was. Man, that's tough. You sure it wasn't Iron Man 2?
I liked Iron Man 2 more than I liked Iron Man 3.
I remember Iron Man 3. Iron Man 2, I'm like, there was that race scene and the dude with the whips, and at the end, him and Rhodey were back to back, and that's it. That's all I've got.
Yeah.
Iron Man 3, I was like, there was that bit with the kid. He was pretty good, and, you know, Tony Stark trying to be snarky, that was pretty neat, and Mandarin was funny, even though didn't turn out to be the real Mandarin. You know, all those cool Iron Man suits, I didn't like that they got blown up, but they were neat. I can tell you the plot of Iron Man 3, and it's not just because I've seen it more recently. I think it's probably because it's a better movie.
It's possible. I can't remember enough about Iron Man 2. I was just excited that it was coming out.
Speaking of great movies, we are going to transition into something that we recorded last week. Very, very excited to bring you guys this. Since we're in Mockbuster month, we contacted some people with the Asylum. We got a hold of Thunder Levin, the writer of Sharknado 1, 2, and 3, and the director of American Warships and Apocalypse Earth, also known as AE. And he sat down and talked with us, had some really great stuff to tell us about how the Asylum makes their movies, about his experience making those movies. And I really, really thrilled to bring this to you guys. And so, yeah. That's coming up in a second. I should do a better transition than that, Tony. But I'm not going to, because here's the interview. Hey, guys, and welcome to a special segment of the Human Echoes podcast. You know that right now we're smack dab in the middle of our Mockbuster month, and one of the biggest names in Mockbuster is The Asylum. And one of the biggest names from The Asylum, and somebody you've heard me talk about, whether it's in some of my other videos or in the podcast, Thunder Levin, writer of the Sharknado movies, writer and director of American Battleships and, well, no, they made you rename that. I'm sorry. American Warships and Apocalypse Earth is here to talk to us. Welcome aboard to the Human Echoes podcast, Under Levin. You are, I'm so excited. I'm just so excited to talk to you. You're a huge...
Well, thanks so much for having me.
You're welcome. So I guess people who might be tuning into this probably know that Sharknado 4 is coming. You mentioned to us beforehand that you are not at liberty to talk about much of that, but I guess most people who know you from the Sharknado movies. So let's start with that. How did you get involved with Sharknado, and how did you get involved with the Asylum, more importantly? Because that's really what I'm interested in, is what was your entry point with them, and how did you get sort of sucked into that wonderful, weird family?
Sucked in is a very good word. I had actually known David Latt, who's one of the partners at the Asylum, for many years through a mutual friend. And we had talked about some other projects in the... This was years ago. Before Asylum even got started, we had talked about projects. And then the Asylum, you know, it started out as an art house distributor, oddly enough. They weren't making these mockbusters and such. And I talked to him once then, but I think in fact he never really took me seriously as a filmmaker at that point, because I hadn't really done anything, you know, beyond student films and such. And so many years passed, and I would check in with him from time to time. And finally, I was getting frustrated with the Hollywood runaround, and, you know, getting deals that would almost get made and then fall apart at the last minute, and people telling me, hey, we like your script, but it needs to be completely rewritten, and things of that nature. And so after many years of that, I decided to raise some money from private investors and make my own film. And so I made a little film called Mutant Vampire Zombies from the Hood, which starred C. Thomas Howell. And that was a great experience, and it went really well. And for what it was, the film turned out pretty good. And so when it was done, I showed it to my old friend David Latt and said, here, see, I can do what I've been saying I could do for years and years. And he couldn't really deny that anymore. And so they hired me to write a movie. I thought actually I was being hired to write and direct a movie called 200 Miles Per Hour, which was a car racing movie. It was kind of a mockbuster of Fast and the Furious 5. And so I went in for my meeting after we'd been talking about the story for a while, and I was talking about my plans for directing it, and they all sort of got this awkward look on their faces, and they said, well, there seems to have been a misunderstanding. We already have a director. We just want you to write it. And so that was disappointing, but still I had fun writing that script, and ended up having to write it in 10 days, which I had never done anything even remotely close to that. And so that went well, and so they decided that the next one I would direct, and that was American Warships. And so that's how I got in with them.
I gotta say, I know people may not be as familiar with American Warships as some of the other stuff the Asylum has put out, but I really respect the films that you've directed, because you bring a really great groundedness to those movies, to the point where I almost think, As a director, you may not be a great fit with the Asylum. I was telling Tony, your movie Apocalypse Earth, if you gave that $100 million budget and basically kept everything else the same, but could really amp up the effects and sort of the things the way they need to be told, that'd be a great sci-fi adventure story. There's not a lot there that you're like, this movie's just, you know, it's got its fun, dumb moments. I mean, the dragon carrying around the android, but it's not stupid. It takes itself seriously, as you know. And I guess one of the things I kind of wonder is, do you think sometimes, if you weren't, especially Sharknado, I mean, if it was just American Warships, if it was just, you know, Apocalypse Earth, you know, maybe wouldn't be such a big deal. But your name is very publicly linked now with these Sharknado films. Does that limit your possibilities elsewhere in Hollywood? Do you think that you maybe would like to do other stuff, but are you worried that that might hurt you from being taken seriously?
Well, there are a whole bunch of different questions in there. The first one is thank you very much, because that's how I feel about both my Asylum films. I went into American Warships with sort of the personal mission that if this wasn't the best film the Asylum had ever made, I was doing something wrong. And one would hope that every director goes in, you know, with that intent. But I was not, and continue to not be the least bit interested in making mockbusters or making intentionally bad movies. And that's an argument we can have about Sharknado too. But I think what you said about AE with the budget, I actually feel that way even more strongly about American Warships, because that's a film where I'm very proud of the work we did on set. The stuff I did with Mario Van Peebles and Carl Weathers, I thought that was all, I'm very proud of that. And then we were let down to a certain extent by the visual effects.
The visual effects in that one are kind of rough. You're not wrong.
And not because the guys at the Asylum aren't good, but because they were trying to do the equivalent of a $200 million film in, you know, 3 weeks with 10 people, what would normally be done in 6 months with several hundred people. So I don't blame them at all. It's just a fact of life there. And because it was my first Asylum film, I went into it not really knowing what they were and were not capable of. And so a lot of that film depended on a lot of story material, really, being conveyed in the visual effects shots. And so that ended up being a weak link. So I think American Warships, if we had had a bigger budget, would have been a perfectly happy studio-level film. And in fact, you know, that was a mockbuster of Battleship. And I will put that film up story point for story point, and character for character and performance for performance against Battleship. And I would say that in every way except production value, our film is better. I mean, Battleship was, let's face it, was not a great movie.
I haven't seen it yet. I've seen your movie, American Warships, at least 3 or 4 times. Not counting, I assume that you know this, but I guess I should say it out that I'm the guy who does this Albert versus the Asylum series on YouTube. Not a ton of people watch it, but I really love the Asylum, and I love kind of making fun of them, but I respect a lot what they're trying to do. And, you know, so in that, you know, some of the stuff I was watching frame by frame a little bit occasionally when I was editing, but you know, American Warships, I've seen often enough where it's definitely, you know, again, like you said, and I guess because of the special effects, especially when they're on that boat, man, that it falls a little bit apart when the SEALs are going over to the alien ship.
Yeah.
But this, in spite of those things, you're right. Like, it's a compelling story. It's an interesting take, and it's a cool alien invasion thing. It's sort of the small scale. Not too small, but, you know, it's just the one alien ship showing up, and then, you know, our guys have to fight them off. They're sort of an advanced scout. Excuse me.
Yeah.
It's a very you write very standard sci-fi stuff, except, and I will say, when you get, I think when you get into Sharknado, you maybe let that slide a little bit, or either that or they're really butchering your scripts.
No. Sharknado's a whole different beast. So after American Warships, when I did AE, after feeling a little burned by the visual effects, I designed AE from the beginning. Actually, AE Apocalypse Earth. When I was making it, it was just called AE, which I thought was very mysterious. And people would always ask me, what does the AE stand for? And I'd say, almost everything. But yeah, so I designed that movie to not need, you know, the same level of visual effects. I tried to keep it much simpler. And so I'm also very proud of that film. And that is the movie that kept me from directing Sharknado, or at least contributed to me not directing Sharknado, because originally I was attached to direct Sharknado as well. But then they were both being shot at the same time, and I chose AE because I'd already done one, you know, tongue-in-cheek disaster film with my zombie film. And so I wanted to try something a bit more heartfelt and a bit more serious. And so I was off in the jungles of Costa Rica having a great time while Anthony Ferrante was here in L.A. Trying to shoot a movie about tornadoes and hurricanes in a two-week stretch that had no rain or clouds whatsoever.
Yeah, that's a problem with those movies as well.
Yeah,
By the way, not to sort of harp on these same points, but you really, you know, one of the things that a director can for sure do, I mean, you may not have control over all the special effects and stuff, but in Apocalypse Earth, and you mentioned the performances in American Warships, but Apocalypse Earth has some really grounded performances as well, and especially the camo girl whose name I've forgotten. I want to say Leela, but yeah. I don't think that's right. She's just like a model, right? But she gives a really good, you know, not a complicated performance, but you got something out of her that doesn't feel like, you know, cheeseball crap. It feels like, okay, you know, this is decent sci-fi action acting.
Yeah, I think so. Thank you. She was a model. She was the most famous model in Costa Rica at the time. And she'd done a lot of international modeling, but she really hadn't done any acting. We had to cast that part locally. The only Americans that the asylum would bring down were Adrian Paul and Richard Grieco. So we had to cast the rest of the film locally. And trying to find someone to play her was the big challenge. And we were getting close to having to start shooting, and we had one actress who was a bit old for the part and not as pretty as I would have liked, but who was a pretty good actress. And then we had one who was the right age and very attractive, but she couldn't act. And we were all getting kind of nervous that we weren't going to find who we needed for the female lead for the film. And then all our formal auditions had actually been wrapped up, and we got a call from our local casting director saying, hey, there's this model who's trying to get into acting, and you should see her. And so she actually came to our hotel, and she brought her mom with her to the audition, because I think she was a little nervous about coming to these strangers' hotel. And we couldn't find a place to audition, and finally they let us into the hotel gym. And so she was doing her audition in the midst of all this workout equipment, and she just blew us away. I mean, she just really nailed her audition. And she certainly had the look, and she was certainly, poised and, just physically, you know, because she was a model, she was just very aware of what she was doing with her body, which was important for this character who would have lived her whole life in the jungle and had to be sort of very at one with her environment and move with a sort of cat-like stealth. She gave a great audition. But then the shoots are so fast that I really didn't have a lot of time to work with her. We were moving so fast, and she was losing so much time in makeup. Because, you know, she was in head-to-toe body paint, that caused certain problems, too. And we actually lost her for most of the first day of the shoot, and that set us behind schedule and made everything a little tense. And so I didn't really get to work with her on her performance as much as I would have liked, but she still managed to do a very good job, I thought. And the fact that she didn't have a clearly Costa Rican accent, because she traveled all over the world, so her accent was not the same as the other people we were auditioning, but at the same time, you know, you could tell she wasn't a native English speaker, that worked perfectly for her character. So it all sort of came together there. I had actually originally intended to have Johanna Watts, who was in American Warships, played the lieutenant. I had originally written the role for her, because she and I are friends, and she actually helped me develop the story a bit. But then when the time came, she wasn't able to go down to Costa Rica on her own dime, and the asylum wouldn't pay for her because she's not a name. And so we had to cast locally, and it all worked out.
I gotta say, by the way, she's a name to me. I know you see her in American Warships, and I looked her up. I was like, who is that? And yeah. She's in a, just a shout out to Johanna Watts, has some new things going on. Now I think she has a movie called Working Girl that's, shopping around at some festivals.
Career Girl.
Thank you.
It's a short though. It's not a feature. And
that shows how much I know. I follow her on Twitter. I'm not like personally, you know, real familiar.
It's actually a great short film, and it's been winning a lot of festivals, and she wrote it and, stars in it. And really, she co-directed it, although she didn't take credit for that. Probably should have. And it's a wonderful little film. And I hope it leads to big things for her. And I hope to keep working with her. There's almost always a part in each of my stories for her. In fact, she was the one. If I had directed Sharknado, she would have played Nova, because I wrote that part with her in mind. So
I do gotta say, Cassie Sherbo brings a. I really enjoy Cassie Sherbo in that part. I think she might be the best parts of those films when she's in them. I love when she shows back up in 3. That girl has some presence.
Yes, she does. And there's an argument to be made that that Nova is in some ways the best character in that film. I mean, Finn is a great hero, and it was a lot of fun just writing this pure hero, Boy Scout kind of character. But Nova's kind of special.
I wanted to go back. You mentioned you got to go to Colombia for AE? Costa Rica. I'm sorry.
Costa Rica.
I knew there was a C in there somewhere.
Yeah, beautiful country. Terrible place to make movies.
I was actually surprised by that. When I watched that movie, I kind of was thinking you were in some like botanical garden or something, that because you have all these sort of obviously outlandish, you know, out there looking plants, but the asylum actually puts you down on location to do that.
Yeah, that was great. I mean, the asylum likes to try different locations. The thing is, you have to be able to hire most of your cast and crew locally, because they won't pay for you to send a whole bunch of people. Basically, it's the director, the producer, the cinematographer, and then at most 2 others. So maybe your makeup person or your production designer.
So all of your actors were from there, or did you have a name? I didn't really know anybody, at least nobody who I saw in the movie seemed like a big name to me, but were all of the people that you had in the film, or at least all the smaller parts, hired from there and around Costa Rica?
Well, obviously Adrian Paul and Richard Grieco were not.
Okay.
In fact, there's an interesting story. I was driving with the location scout, who really was just a tour guide that we hired to be our location scout, because there are no location scouts in Costa Rica. Or maybe there's one, and they were working on what was shooting there at the same time. I don't remember.
Anyway, with more money.
Something with a lot more money. And so anyway, we were driving down from the big city San Jose to the place on the coast where we were going to shoot. And he said, "So who's going to be in this movie?" And I said, "Well, Adrian Paul." And he says, "I don't know who that is." And I said, "Well, you remember a few years back there was this TV series called Highlander?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, this is the Highlander." And he looks at me with this dumbfounded expression. His jaw drops open. And he says, "Adrian Paul is the no. That what was it? Duncan MacLeod is coming here." And he was just stunned. Yeah. So Adrian Paul and Richard Grieco, obviously the asylum paid to send down. And then there were 2 American actors who had both been in American Warships, Gray Hawks and Jay Cardell. Who flew down on their own dime, actually, and worked as local hires. Because that was the only way. We had to cast locally. And I said, "You know, I'd love to have you guys in this movie, but they're not going to pay for you to come down." And they volunteered to come down on their own dime.
That's one thing I love about watching the Asylum movies is that there are faces that pop up in not necessarily all of them, but many, many of them. And kind of, we started off talking about how there's, you know, sort of suck you into their family, but it really does seem like that there's a you know, a cast of people that are just sort of always around. And then you have occasionally people wander in and wander out, but there are several faces that you'll see.
Yes, there are. Yeah.
One of them is
Gerald Webb, who you'll see in about half of the Asylum movies, I think, because he was the casting director for years, and he always put himself in their films. There are a lot of familiar faces that they keep bringing back once they get somebody. You know, it's a difficult working environment when you have to move that fast and you have so little money. So anyone who can do that, who can, you know, sort of be a team player and isn't going to be a prima donna and is going to work hard despite the conditions and be able to deliver a performance under those circumstances, they're going to keep bringing them back. And it makes perfect sense.
There is something, we just actually reviewed Sharknado 3 for our podcast last week. And
I hope you were kind.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. Tony's not so much.
I'm not the biggest like schlock fan or like the mockbuster type fan. But Al has actually got me to the point where like I used to hate them, and now I can actually start seeing the things that he really likes about them, and I just take it a lot less seriously and kind of it's more of a ride for me than it used to be. So I've found the ways that I can like them. There were parts that like that just had me shaking my head a little bit, but I like your use of Mark Cuban as the president. Like there was some really awesome stuff in that. So I enjoyed it more than I expected it. And I said, it's not my type of movie, but I had fun with that one. Same with like Abraham Lincoln versus Zombies and some of these others that have been put out recently.
Right. Yeah. Abraham Lincoln versus Zombies was pretty good. The Mark Cuban thing was, I thought, a high point of that film. I was very excited. The night we shot that, I was on set that night, and to hear him, you know, and he does come off as presidential. He, as Donald Trump is showing, Mark Cuban could certainly be president, and so it felt very real on set. And when he started introducing Finn, and I thought about how far Finn as a character had come in the last 2 years. And then I thought about how far all of us, you know, as filmmakers and this bizarre wild ride we've been on with Sharknado, how far we've all come in the last 2 years. And it was all sort of culminated in that introduction. And it just sent chills down my spine, just watching the first take on set.
I gotta say, while I love The Asylum, up until Sharknado 3, I did not love those movies. I always kind of felt like they didn't quite get where I wanted to go. But there's something different about 3. And I can tell, this is the way I feel as a viewer. It seems to me like y'all, and I know that stop taking yourself seriously sounds like a dumb thing to say about the Sharknado films, but 3 feels like the one where you finally just kind of threw off the chains and you're like, you know what? People are watching these. We're going to get crazy with this Sharknado idea. Is there any, am I way off base in feeling that way about 3, or is that, does that have a little bit of validity from where you're standing?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I felt like the second one, I feel like the second one is the best of the three. Personally, I think it's the one where we came closest to capturing the intent of the script. And I felt like the second one was what the fans were trying to make the first one be. The third one, maybe it's just my ego talking, but in the third one, maybe you're right. Maybe we were doing more crazy stuff, and it was a little less character and plot oriented.
I'm not trying to put you on the spot or like get you to talk about
movies. The second one is my favorite of the three, but there are things I love in all of them. And there was certainly a lot of fun, great moments we had in the third one. And you may be right that it was a case of, well, let's just let's just do everything we can. And there was stuff that got into the third one that was supposed to be in the second one and didn't make it in. And so there was an opportunity to do that. We've still never done the scene I've been trying to get in since the first movie, which is Finn surfing down a street in a city. Originally, it was just going to be Finn surfing down Wilshire Boulevard in L.A. in the first one. And then in the second one, we were going to have him surfing down Fifth Avenue in an upturned hot dog cart umbrella. and I was just really excited about that, and then that never happened. And so then finally we sort of did a pale version of it in the third one where Mark McGrath surfs down the stairs on the paintings in the White House. And so we finally sort of got that moment in. There are moments in the third movie that I absolutely love. Especially at the end where he's falling in the shark and he punches a hole in it and sticks his parachute out. I mean, that's my favorite moment in that whole movie.
Oh, really? I think for me, it's that first moment when Cassie Sherbo shows up again and like kind of upstages Finn with her like Semper Paratus thing where he's like always, and she's like, no, I'm prepared. All right.
Right. Right.
You're driving around in a little dinky foreign car or something. I've got the goods.
Well, he was in a rental, so what do you expect of him? But it's funny because I'm actually a little disappointed by that moment because I wanted to do a cheesy line there when she first shows up, and Anthony changed it so that she just says, "Hi, Finn," or something. And I wanted her to open the door, reach out her hand to him, and say, "Come with me if you want to live." And Anthony vetoed that idea. So that moment moment I always wanted to be even bigger than it was. But yeah, her first appearance, Anthony and I talked about that, about how she'd appear out of the fog and suddenly reveal who she was, and that was a good moment because I think she was missed in the second one. And I was so glad we were able to bring her back.
From what I can tell from IMDb, she's not going to be in the fourth one, which I'm a little bit sad about, but...
Yeah.
Oh, and I know you can't say much, but I was going to say, you said, you kind of threw everything at the screen for... Go ahead.
Come back to me after the fourth one is released, and we'll talk about Nova and the fourth one.
Well, I did want to say, in general, you mentioned you kind of threw everything at the screen in the third one. Is there still stuff left to throw at the screen in four?
Not only is there stuff left to throw at the screen, but there was a lot of stuff we wanted to do that we weren't even able to do. I actually have a story arc for 5 through 7, and we have to see if Sci-Fi will approve my story arc. Because if people keep watching, we'll keep making them, I think.
Well, I will keep watching. And by the way, I know you don't have any say over this, but I tell everybody who is even remotely linked to the Asylum that I get a chance to, if you see David Michael Latt, tell him we want more Mega Shark movies too. I know they're not as big as Sharknado, but that is my jam, and I was disappointed by Mega Shark vs. Colossus, but Mega Shark vs. Mecha Shark, in my mind, is maybe the high point of everything in the Asylum. I love that giant shark rolling around on them stupid tank treads, and I would love to see that come back. Plus, they're doing a film with Jason Statham called Meg. They're adapting the ultimate giant shark movie. They gotta come back with another Mega Shark mockbuster.
I just met John Turteltaub, who's directing that, just last weekend.
That's a seminal book. I don't want to get off on it, but that is huge in my mind as far as getting me turned on to the sharksploitation giant shark thing.
Yeah, I love that book, and we were trading fish stories about making shark movies.
Well, I think Tony, did you have anything you wanted to ask? As usual, I talk and you don't get to say much. Did you have anything you wanted to ask our guest?
I don't think so. I think we covered, you actually asked some of the questions that I had written down. The only thing I was kind of curious about is what's it like whenever like Sharknado 3 actually comes out or any of these and it hits Sci-Fi and you see that it actually is becoming kind of an event with each progressive movie. Like, that's got to be really cool in an era where it's, like, just Netflix binging and people are kind of out of sync and people are actually, like, tuning in to watch this live and actually talk about it and just be all over the place, like, compared to some of the other stuff you've worked on. Sorry, go ahead.
I have done a couple of public speaking appearances, and I have a whole speech about that, about how, you know, from the beginning of time, from the beginning of human history, from Neanderthals sitting around a campfire to the ancient Greek plays, to Shakespeare, to, I don't know, everybody having to watch The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson a generation ago. There have been these communal storytelling that provides a common language for our society. And it's what holds our society together. And as the way we consume media has fractured, you know, with everybody watching things at different times, where they want, when they want, we're sort of losing that that communal shared language. So in fact, Sharknado has saved civilization as we know it, because it brings people together at the same time, watching the same thing and letting them talk about it. Yes, it's been an incredible ride. It's amazing and awesome. And that first night when the first movie blew up on Twitter, it was just the most surreal experience of my life. And the fact that it's become this this annual event is a remarkable and wonderful thing. And I hope it keeps on going. And I hope people keep tuning in. And I hope it continues to be this event. You know, every year, for about 3 or 4 weeks in July, all of a sudden I'm a famous person, and people are interviewing me, and we're, you know, going to Comic-Con and stuff. And it's just wonderful. It's such a blast. And the fact that people have so much fun with it is just remarkably rewarding. And it's just wonderful. And the way kids take to it, because kids don't, you know, kids don't watch Sharknado ironically. They're just in it. They're just enjoying it for the adventure and the fun. And it's just great to see.
Well, Thunder Levin, you're always a famous person to me. and I always look forward to what you're doing next. I hope the Asylum lets you direct some more stuff and you get to keep working on Sharknado. That's not something I got to ask. Do you have projects coming up beyond Sharknado 4?
Yeah, actually, we didn't talk about that. I have another Sci-Fi Channel movie that's lined up. We haven't signed the contracts yet, so I can't really talk about it, but I should be writing that pretty soon. And that would come out, I guess, in the fall of 2017. I've got two TV series that I'm pitching to the networks right now. One is sort of Sharknado-esque. It's this big, crazy, you know, tongue-in-cheek sci-fi adventure. And then one is a very dark, serious apocalyptic kind of show. I need to go in and actually have a meeting with the Asylum and talk about directing something else for them, possibly. And I've got an independent feature that I'm developing and hoping to find money for. So a bunch of things going on. And then not all, you know, tongue-in-cheek like Sharknado. Because, yeah, I mean, I would like to keep doing Sharknado and have that be my wacky outlet and then do other more serious things around it. And also, I think that's a model for sci-fi. You know, sci-fi as a network is trying to rebrand itself. They're trying to get back to more serious stuff. And having Sharknado as sort of the annual exception to that, the celebration of the B movie, I think still works and fits into their brand. So
I'm okay with both things. You know, we can have The Expanse and we can have Z Nation. Let's not feel like we have to pigeonhole. I really really love Z Nation. That's a whole. I mean, I know that the
Yeah, I love that too. In fact, I was hoping to direct for them this year, and it didn't work out. So I'm hoping Carl Schaefer will bring me on board if there's a fourth season.
Well, that'll be awesome. Thank you so much for taking time out to talk to us, sir. It's been a legitimate honor, and yeah, looking forward to Sharknado 4. Hope it's awesome. And good luck with everything that you're working on, man.
Okay, thanks a lot.
And that was our interview with Thunder Levin. That was a really fun talk to have. Like, I was kind of sitting back, just kind of enjoying listening to it. Al has a lot more connection with these movies than I do. But, like, you can actually see a lot more where they're coming from with the asylum, with everything else that's going on over there.
I like to believe that I might be one of the few people who's interviewed him that has actually seen American Battleships and After Earth.
Well, considering his reaction, I think you probably are. Like, a lot of people who've interviewed him have at least seen Sharknado. I'm sure a lot are very dismissive of his other work. They don't even care. And you were able to just be like, oh, yeah, and then what if this happens? Like you're just getting into what's happening with characters and everything else and, like, giving him props for things. And, I could hear a difference in his voice whenever he was talking to you, just kind of this, like, uplifted thing. So that was definitely cool.
Well, I respect him a lot. And I could have – this episode has already gone long, but I felt like after that interview, I didn't even get to ask all the questions I wanted to ask. I could have been on for him, just him, I think, for at least an hour.
Probably.
Talking about more stuff. But that's what we got. We really appreciate him taking the time to be with us. And we really appreciate you for taking the time to listen. And now we want you to help us out by going to humanechoes.com and clicking the Become a Member button if you are not already.
If you become a member, you get access to the bonus podcast, which is our favorite product that we get to make and put out. Like, that's one of the best things. Talk to any of our members. They'll tell you that it's just fantastic. We also have a few samples up here if you look back a few episodes in our library.
At the there's different levels of membership. At the $2 level, you get just the bonus podcast. Going all the way up to the $20 level, and there's multiples in between, but we have pins, we have stickers,
we have t-shirts.
You get a postcard. You get the shout out on the show, and there's a t-shirt at the $20 level. So there's a lot of cool stuff. We appreciate all of our members that help us out, and we would like for you to be one as well. Also, go to humanechoes.com for all of our other great content. As I mentioned earlier in the show, the Human Echoes Rundown. Tony has a post every Thursday, the Tony Post, I call it, because it doesn't have a fancy name. Every once in a while, it is a five facts.
Yeah, every other week is a five facts, and then I alternate between doing a personal post and a five facts.
Yeah, because I wish I could show you my screen right now. There's there's us kind of like going along at our normal website numbers, and then we post a list, and the giant bar of views for that day. We're like, oh, there's a list. That's why everything on the internet is lists, you guys, because that's all people want. That's all people click on.
And we don't make you go through a slideshow to see them all. It's just laid bare.
It's all there on one page.
Although my Helltree post actually got pretty good traffic, all things considered. So. They're doing all right.
Next week, we will be coming back to you with the final week of Mockbuster Month, talking about Three-Headed Shark Attack, starring quote-unquote Danny Trejo, and one of the Asylum's best shark effects, and some really dumb people on a paddle boat. Hopefully, I won't be sick for this one. I have enjoyed it a lot in the past. I've seen it two or three times.
I've heard that this one's better than a lot of them. Like, I've actually seen some buzz around this movie.
It has its problems, but it definitely, if you can get into the cheesy fun, I mean, it's a three-headed shark attack. So, yeah, don't do two-headed shark attack. I don't like that one. I skipped over that one. We don't have to talk about that. We'll talk about that later sometime, Tony. Maybe I'll do Oliver vs. the Asylum for it eventually. Maybe not. Who can tell? You guys can tell in the future of the Human Echoes podcast.
All right.
Thanks for listening.
You guys have a good week. Bye.